So today we're going to talk about the resiliency of whooping cranes in coastal communities along the Texas coast. I'm Liz Smith. I'm the North America Program Director and Texas Program Leader.
I'm Terry Turney. I'm the Land and Water Conservation Director for International Crane Foundation here in Rockport.
Right. So the International Crane Foundation does work worldwide and lead or with our partners work on all 15 species of cranes and what they require to survive and thrive, those ecosystems and watersheds and flyways on which they depend. And of those 15 species of cranes, 11 are either threatened with extinction or vulnerable. So we work on the two crane species in North America, the sandhill crane, which is the most numerous crane and encompasses a broad area of breeding in the northern part of the continent and even over into Russia, and then migrate down different flyways to their wintering grounds. And then the whooping crane, which is the rarest crane in the world. And it basically historically, you know, nested in the boreal forest, integrating into the prairie pothole region, the Great Plains, over into the lower Great Lakes states. And then wintered along the Gulf of Mexico, as well as the Southern Atlantic, and even in the intermountain plateaus of Mexico. So that population that we now occurs is nests up in Wood Buffalo National Park, where they raise usually one chick that grows an inch a day, learns to fly in 3 months, and then goes with its parents down to South Texas in winters with their parents learning how to eat new prey items. The blue crab is the most numerous prey item in the coastal system when it's healthy. And this is very difficult for a young crane to navigate those big claws and also the hardness of the carapace. And so they learn this throughout the winter. And then as they migrate north, eventually they are left behind by their parents, perhaps on the Platte River, wake up one morning and discover their parents are gone and they join other subadults that they migrate with for the next 2 to 5 years till they pair up. So when we look at this migration corridor for the Aransas Wood Buffalo population, we have these goals along their important parts of their cycle. So in the breeding habitat, the goal is to protect habitat that can support 250 breeding pairs. And this is something that we feel is achievable as Wood Buffalo National Park is over 1 million acres and it is surrounded by First Nations land as well. In the flyway, there is these birds migrate along this 2,500 mile corridor that's only about 200 miles wide. They start out by getting to the Saskatchewan grain fields where they oftentimes can stay for as long as 6 weeks, feasting on waste grain and gaining strength for those young juveniles that are making their first trip. And then along the Great Plains corridor moving south, they use these shallow braided rivers like conservation ladders as they come down every night to roost. So it isn't one long flight, it's many days. And so this is very key. This is a very expansive area. There's a lot of partners to work with to identify how to conserve those habitats for stopover and staging. And then when we get to the wintering grounds, we actually do have a habitat goal for this 1,000 individuals and 250 breeding pairs that would actually downlist the species from endangered to threatened. And so this wintering working group that's a consortium of federal and state agencies and non-governmental organizations and universities, we've created what we feel is a goal required in order to support this recovering population. So along the Texas coast, there is very low coastal relief. There's the continental shelf out in the Gulf, and then this this very, very low elevation rise as you move inland. And so in some places, it can be 30 to 40 miles away from the coast, and it's still below 30 feet in elevation. So this provides a lot of benefits as well for us in terms of creating a buffer when storm surges and hurricanes come through. The natural habitats are able to withstand that. Our Hurricane Harvey that occurred in 2017, areas where this natural habitat occurred, there was less destruction than for the built communities. And then we also know that as sea level rises, that it will actually affect the shorelines and where habitat is and what type of habitat is available for whooping cranes. So along with this corridor of low elevation, we have this real diversity of coastal wetlands.
Thank you, Liz. Looking at the coastal wetlands, you can see on the map that the greenish, dark blue color, darkish green, excuse me, color moving up from the estuarine marsh in central Texas coast down into South Texas, we get fresher and fresher just because of the rainfall amounts get higher and higher. Looking at the map, I realized, Liz, that I've lived in four towns that have the word port in them. So I've lived up and down the coast from the bottom to the top, and it's an amazing area to work, but the diversity is truly amazing. So when we look at the coastal wildlife diversity all along the coast, from that saltier marsh on up into freshwater marshes near the Louisiana border, you can see the myriad of species that are up and down the coast. You may find your favorite species on here. And we had Rary, our biologist, that put this slide together out in the woodlands the other day, and she got to meet her first armadillo. So that was a good thing. So, but coastal diversity is amazing, the water influence on the species. Some of y'all might need a little definition, a quick definition of estuarine marsh habitat. So I threw this slide in there. You can see that it's, typical salinities are up 22 parts per thousand. There's a lower plant diversity, in some areas, almost a monoculture of plants, all of the spartina grasses that are out there. The tidal influenced, we have a tidal influence of here in Texas about, a foot to a foot and a half at the most sometimes, unless it's tidal surge. But there's a complex food webs. You look at all the phytoplankton and zooplankton that's in the water and feeding the food chains up. It's very complex. It's a very important marine nursery, marine species nursery. So you can see some of the small crabs and the shrimp in this photo. And that's what supplies the blue crab population for whooping cranes. It's one of their valued resources for protein here on the coast. And then you move up the coast with that freshwater influence, both inflows or the rainfall amounts here in Texas, the inflows from the rivers and from just the rainfall itself. When I worked in Port Arthur up at the J.D. Murphy Wildlife Management Area, the last year I worked, we had 98 inches of rainfall. So it's really influences the marsh. There's more higher plant diversity. There's a little runoff. There's a very high prey species diversity up there. And one of the important factors is the year-round food source. There is always, I'd say there's always something to eat, for especially when these cranes move into this area. And through the reduced human disturbance in there, the marshes are hard to navigate, and where they are, and there's some large acreages of freshwater marsh up there. But the human disturbance, we had 46 species of subspecies of mosquitoes in that area. You did not want to be out in that marsh when there were numbers of mosquitoes. So anyway, thank you. Okay.
Just a minute here.
You can see the great blue heron in the bottom picture. There we go. And we talk about our land use up and down the coast. We've got the developed properties are about 12%. When we include the housing developments, it used to be second homes. With everything happening with COVID and people realizing they can work from home, there are a lot of residences, people moving to the coast for full-time permanent residences. So, and then we've got the protected areas, protected lands that are about 7% with the National Wildlife Refuges and the state wildlife management areas and all the land trust properties and conservation easements on private lands make up that 7%. In the industry, we have about 1%. Although it's impactful on the environment, it's reduced amount percentage. So, and then private lands, 80% private lands on the Texas coast, which we're fortunate to be working with. So this slide is the Katy Prairie development. I grew up in Houston, and Katy is 10 miles west of Houston. Well, it's actually in the middle of Houston, it feels like. But you can see the development over time into subdivisions and neighborhoods. I grew up going out in the rice fields in Katy and swimming in the rice field ponds. And just, it's amazing watching this just in my lifetime. So
I'd run that again.
Yeah, you can see those potholes and then the little bit of a development, and now it is all developed. And I-10, the highway that runs through the east and west through the middle of the picture is now 10 lanes on each side. So it's almost a 20-lane highway in the middle of Houston, going into Houston, excuse me. So there's so much traffic. So it's not the days of old. But we work with... I'm fortunate enough to work with landowners here in about 80%, like we said, our Texas coastal lands are privately owned. So that's where we see the future of conservation with wildlife is with private landowners. They manage excellent properties. And I'm fortunate enough to champion whooping crane conservation with some of the neatest ranches. They're incredible. Some of the Texas heritage ranches, the ranches found along the coast, some of them date back, can trace their beginnings with the Spanish land grants, where the impresarios were tasked with bringing families to Texas to settle by the Spanish government. And we all know those, some of those large holdings, the King Ranch, the O'Connor Ranch, and a number of others that are I'm fortunate to get to work with them, and their histories are amazing. So we're going to jump into rice farming. We've been discussing in the office when these birds do expand out of the Aransas wood buffalo population, moving northward. We've got country lands that are used for rice farming, and these birds in Louisiana and in Texas, some have used these agricultural fields and rice farming. So I just wanted to touch on a little bit of rice farming history or ideas. So it began in 1850s. I'm not going to read all of it, but it's we are ranked fifth. We were first or second throughout history. And then California and Arkansas are raising more rice than Texas at this moment. But most of our rice is exported. And it's a $2 million+ industry annually. And it's planted in February and March. It's got a 120-day growing season. We harvest in July. This is your word of the day. So everybody has to remember the the possible second crop. Some farmers grow it, some don't. It rises from the stems. It's called a ratoon crop. So ratoon is your word of the day. So it resprouts and then there in July and grows, and they harvest that second crop most of the time in October. And an average yield is about 7,600 pounds per acre on rice. So, and a little comparison of dryland farming, and you'll see in some later slides that we've got a lot of dryland farming in Texas also. But dryland, it's one crop, possibly two, or sources of income. They may harvest and then move cattle into it or make silage out of what's left or whatever. But the rice farming, we love and the aspects of it. It's flooded field. There are three, possibly four sources of income for farmers. So they grow rice. They may get a second crop, a ratoon crop. And then they can either contract or themselves run crawfish, have crawfish farms. Crawfish has become an amazingly large industry across the nation. And then there are the geese on the bottom of the right-hand screen is snow geese, and the waterfowl leases make up a large part of the income of the landowners. And then we also can have limited grazing on some of those properties if the fencing's available. But the great thing for wildlife conservation is it keeps water on the landscape. We've got water there for all the migrating shorebirds, all the migrating waterfowl, all the resident species that live there can survive with that water on the ground. So go ahead. So you can see the cropland cover data we've gotten for USDA, United States Department of Agriculture, in the dryland farming in the bottom of the screen, bottom of the picture, moving up the coast, some dryland farming. One of the aspects of rice farming is that they can rotate crops. So they go from rice to either crawfish or dryland farming, which will put some nitrogen back in the soil and all. But you can see right here in this area, the rice production is in blue, and it's a water availability aspect. Of rice. You've got to have water, obviously, to flood the plant. The plant roots has to stay in water. So weed control, it also is a wetland plant that adapted. But you can see over time, you can see the rice versus the dry land farming. And it's because we've got a water source coming down the Colorado River and water that is dedicated to rice farmers, so they can have in most periods have water availability for the rice farming. So, and then you can see Southeast Texas, where we're working with some of the Louisiana non-migratory flock is coming into this area, and you can see the wetlands and the rice production that is in this area, and it's a rainfall related. It's just a wetter clayer soils, and it's indicative of rice farming. And then, of course, over in Louisiana, that you can see in the main picture, that's all their rice farming country. So, okay. And here's a map showing the changes in rice production along the Colorado River. Like I said, it's a water availability. If there's enough water From upstream that's being used from San Antonio and Austin for water for city municipalities. But if we get the water, they can grow their rice. And it's a rotational aspect also. But it changes from year to year. So it's not necessarily a dependable habitat, but there's enough close proximity that most of the wildlife can move or migrate over to water if they need to. So, And we're talking, this slide makes my mouth water, I'm sorry, even early in the morning, crawfish. Like I said, crawfish farming has become an amazingly large business here in Texas and Louisiana, obviously. And, you know, the rice is harvested in July, and then they hold water on the fields. They seed those fields with crawfish that somebody's carried over the year, you know, sacks of crawfish to get them going. They reproduce. And then crawfish season's late winter, spring. Big Easter celebrations with crawfish boils in Louisiana and in Texas becoming a tradition. And you hold the water at 12 to 14 inches, and you can stagger those crops. You can have rice, crawfish, and then rice the next year, or rice, crawfish, and go into a fallow a field, or soybeans that put nitrogen back in the soil. And then if all else fails and it's too dry, our farmers typically switch to row crops. And some graze if the fencing is available, but they'll usually switch to row crops: cotton, grain sorghum, corn also. And then a typical yield for crawfish is 600 to 1,000 pounds per acre per season. So in the lower left, you can see the harvest boat. They use boats now that they go up and down the rows. And they run the traps. You can see the traps, and they do that on a daily basis and sack them up and ship them out cold. So, okay, thank you. And then waterfowl leases, like I said, are a large part of income and always have been for farmers along the coast, especially rice farmers. We've got about 6 million waterfowl waterfowl numbers come to Texas, with about 2 million using the mid-coast rice prairie region. And rice provides a lot of nutrition for those birds when they come in. Either fallow rice or the rice that's fallen off during harvest and all. But the waterfowl hunters in the area, it's in the millions of dollars that they spend for economic benefits to the communities and to the farmers, the landowners. Texas sells about 1.15 million hunting licenses annually here in the state. So, but they harvest the rice, they maintain the water on the rice, or they pump water back in if it happens to be dry for the waterfowl hunters. Typical daily fees are, you know, $150 to $250, and then season leases can run all the way up to $15,000 per person per season. So it's a very large industry here in Texas. And and then we talked a little bit about wildlife diversity, and this is prey items, the diversity of prey items that are found in those freshwater rice fields some of the adjoining freshwater marshes. And you can see the number of prey species. It's amazing for whooping cranes that are available and will be.
Okay. You know, that's so interesting to relate to our program, because in the map, you see the current range of the Aransas Wood buffalo population in bright orange. That's where we've worked since 2011. And most of our work has been done, you know, within protected lands, the Aransas National Wildlife Refuge, the wildlife management areas, and on these private ranches that are grazing cattle and have limited freshwater resources. So as we go into the expansion range of the whooping crane into these pale orange counties, we start encountering all the things that Terry's been talking about, these working lands that have more habitat that is under, you know, agriculture, but is also really beneficial for all of these waterfowl species and shorebirds, et cetera. So it's only natural that whooping cranes would begin to utilize these as well. So our work with landowners is still so key, And it does, show that we're in a working landscape. We're in a landscape that provides income to not only to the landowner, but also to the communities. And it is a resilient landscape because of the landowner practices, the rotation of crops, the use of those areas for leases, et cetera. So it's very important that we understand all of this as we continue to work with our Whooping Crane expansion. So because, our expansion in our program occurred last year and Terry joined us in September, the amount of landowners that we are working with now along the coast has just risen exponentially. It's such a benefit to have Terry, who's worked along the coast his almost 40-year career, that has these good relationships with these landowners and these managers, that we're able to work very quickly and expand our own range as well. So I really, appreciate the expertise and the personality that Terry brings to our program. In addition, this work that we're doing in the Southeast Texas with the those Louisiana populations over there, it's very important that we include that because as these cranes expand into the, Aransas wood buffalo moves northeastward, Louisiana cranes may expand southwestward, that they're going to be inhabiting these same kind of working lands, and the things that we're doing in East Texas will be really important to introduce to our landowners. So in that first 10 years, we really did focus a lot on ranches when we weren't on the refuge. And so our work with our partners, such as San Antonio Bay Partnership, with the Waters for Wildlife Program, of which they're a primary lead on, although there are other organizations involved in that as well, Friends of Aransas, for example. But the funding that we get through the Coastal Bend Bays and Estuaries, allowed us to go out and identify where cranes needed additional drinking water during droughts, and then be able to put either restore a well or put in a new well and provide this water. And it opened those ranch gates, and it gave us that relationship with the landowner and the trust that we needed to continue our conversations. And so, and it's a very partnership-driven endeavor. And so here, the people shown in here, include NGOs, federal land partners, the U.S. Whooping Crane Coordinator, and ranchers in looking at this. And in this next year, we're not putting in wells. We have two more wells to complete, but we are also developing a guidance document of managing these wetlands. And it's not that we're going in and telling anybody what to do. We're asking the landowners what they do to manage these to share with other landowners.
Thank you, Liz. And along those lines, we're hoping to expand the Texas Water for Wildlife program with our partners working on it and possibly looking at larger acreages of surface water, requiring larger pumps, pumping times, and creating those wetlands over large expanses that will benefit all wildlife species, and then expanding into other regions of Texas, hoping we'll talk a little bit about corridors and hoping to assist with those movements of wildlife and whooping cranes back and forth. So. And also working with those, let's mention those landowners up in Southeast Texas. I've got having part of my career up in Southeast Texas with Texas Parks and Wildlife Department, established some good friends, good landowners that I work with. We've got a partnership with Natural Resources Conservation Service, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and the International Crane Foundation. We're working with these landowners to facilitate habitat conservation agreements with them if they're impacting their habitat, their marsh, and the future populations of whooping cranes that may come from either Louisiana flock, coming over into Texas. They're working with them to how to handle these populations moving. And so, it's already happening, and we can see it continue happening. So we're assisting with the development of these conservation agreements with the landowners.
Okay. And what's really exciting about all of this work in East Texas is these populations expand is that, you know, as the cranes grow older coming from Louisiana, you know, there's a good possibility that they may become nesting there. So getting ahead of the curve is always nice. So with our goal in the wintering range and looking at how far along we are, oftentimes when we give presentations, you know, that question is asked. It's a good question. You know, how many are there now and how far along are we in conserving the essential habitat that they need? So this is a population map of the a graph of the Aransas wood buffalo population. And so it was the reached an all-time low in 1941, only 16 birds on the Aransas National Wildlife Refuge. Many were writing them off, saying that just too small of a population to recover. There's a might be a genetic bottleneck. But over time and with a lot of work of conserving lands and protecting them from disturbance, but they did continue to increase in numbers at first rather slowly, and then increasing fairly rapidly in the 2000s on. And so in these counts and then later estimates by the Fish and Wildlife Service, in 2019, the estimate for this population was about 500. So that's about halfway there. That's a good thing. And then also, then we would expect a midpoint for 125 nests in the nesting grounds. And in that survey by the Canadian Wildlife Service, they there was about a little less than 100. So that's not quite there yet. But consider that it takes 2 to 5 years for these birds to mature, to find a mate, to successfully raise young. And so we have a very, very young proportion of the population that will be contributing fairly soon. So that's the good news. And then when we are asked, well, how much is conserved? This is where this is not an easy one to answer. But we do want to participate in being able to deal with answering that question and working with our partners in a confidential manner. And so the GIS habitat conservation database that we are building, Rary, our new whooping crane biologist, and being mentored by Dorn Moore, our GIS expert, we're developing this in a way that it can be used as both a tracking tool and also a planning tool. So we have the habitats that are provided by a land use land cover product by the Texas Parks and Wildlife. National wetland inventory maps give us more detailed view on those specialty areas that cranes need by Fish and Wildlife Service. Location data is then used to link those where they are with the type of habitat that they use. And that's been developed in a series of whooping crane habitat suitability models, of which the Crane Foundation led a group in 2014. And now the Fish and Wildlife Service has released their product and we're using it. So the brightest red areas are the highest suitability in this model. And then we use counties as our accounting system to keep confidentiality of private lands, conservation easements, et cetera, but relating the answers to a county total of conservation. We are able to go in and use land parcel data by county to create maps of these areas for our partners that would be confidential to them if they preferred, and also help us out. And then relating this to a US database by the US Geological Service, We would, if this was complete, we would have, our job would be done. However, it isn't comprehensive because people, entities need to provide their data to this mapping program. And so it's fairly easy to update federal and state lands just by getting them in, but to update non-governmental lands is more of a challenge. And I just completed a presentation to the Texas Coastal Conservation Conference and engaging them in working with us to help get this up to date, and got some great feedback. And then from this, then we're able to calculate how many acres are within a suitable area for whooping cranes, and then track that progress over time, not just for us, but for our partners as well. So in this land cover layer, there's actually, this is the suitability, ranging from that bright red is highly suitable down to the blue, less suitable, and then overlaid by the conservation layer that that RARE is building. And so we look at this and we say, well, it's a little bit, you know, we don't want to go pixel by pixel. So we're creating these more generalized high priority polygons. But as these cranes expand, they are expanding within these high priority areas that the historic population used, which is just along the coast. But there's also many records of cranes utilizing other habitats, because the model was built on habitat around the Aransas Wildlife Refuge. And now we're getting into those other habitats, more fresh marsh, intermediate marsh, working lands. And so that's very exciting. And this is just an example of a few of the records that were collected during the annual survey. And then this is basically just showing how we go in and actually use the parcel data to update the conservation layer. And so we're able to increase that capability of that layer.
Yep. And these are, and to facilitate, to help us work with these areas, we've basically deemed core conservation areas up and down the coast. It's a working model when we can go to each area and determine what we need and are working with ranches and both our partners and with ranches and landowners. And you can see this is just an example of the mid-coast here at the Aransas Refuge and country around it. We're looking at those corridors, looking at where whooping cranes will use those corridors, with moving back and forth between those areas of we'll call them areas of protection right now, but those core areas that they utilize, and then what their needs are. So, and you can see what this is a little further up the coast, with all the there in green is again the refuge systems, the wildlife management areas of the state, the conservation easements, all of those protected areas, those areas of refuge for the birds. We're looking at these corridors, looking at the movement back and forth and how we can facilitate habitat within those corridors. Then further up the coast, the movements in between up there through the marshes, and also they're, you know, these birds are covering large expanses at times. So this is Louisiana population area. They may come over and they are using some of this. So, yes.
All right. And so then as we look at, you know, what habitats we need to conserve now, remember that there was that adjacent coastal prairies and marshes and working lands that are next to the coastal marshes that they traditionally use. And so while we're looking at what we need to conserve now, climate change results in sea level rise along all the coasts around the world. But in Texas, there's an additional factor in which we also have land subsidence. The land is sinking. And it can be from the compaction of soils that have been laid down by sea level rise, sea level drops over hundreds of thousands of years. And then also oil extraction and gas extraction, and also water that increases the amount of water that floods the landscape. So when we were looking at that elevation model, we saw that, you know, that there's a really broad expanses that will be inundated over time. The question now, though, is that we can't wait until that happens to try to put some conservation practices on that and limit development, built development. We need to do it now for the future. And even at this 5-foot rise, you know, you see that, you know, it's necessary to get that into a conservation practice now in something that may take 100 years to happen. This benefits not just the whooping crane, but all those species that we're talking about. And, you know, it's very apparent to the ranchers and farmers that this is happening. They've seen it happen over the, you know, the past, even, you know, my record of sea level rise. It's very, you know, habitats have gone from shorebird habitat to diving duck habitat in just, you know, 40 years. And so, you know, we recognize it in Texas that it is happening. Those people that actually, you know, work outside and work with the land and the water. So our key is to use our habitat conservation database to also identify those areas and make them priority conversations. So in this portfolio of a particular area, this is the Seadrift Port O'Connor Ridge. It's just to the northeast of the Aransas National Wildlife Refuge and is very similar in formation. It's a barrier strand peninsula. It used to be the shoreline a long time ago. It has a lot of sand deposits on it and a lot of wetlands and ridges and swales. And so it was inconceivable that at one point how we could conserve this habitat for both for wildlife and for working lands. And this is a success story. And the map on the left shows all the conservation easements that are in the Welder Flats area that have been put in place by our partners. The Powderhorn Ranch there at Texas Parks and Wildlife was one of the largest acquisitions from the funding available from the Deep Horizon oil spill. You know, there's adjacent land, private land that's been put into a conservation easement that was also funded by that program. So you can see that there's possibilities, and this happens now because the landowners, the parcels are fairly large. So then as we see the sea level rise, even in this portion down by Welder Flats in the lower left, you see that this low relief of land, 9 feet over 3 miles, that as sea level rises, that habitat you know, moves inland and it's available because of these easements. There will be cranes on Welder Flats for a long, long time. And we thank those landowners for, you know, working with us, with all our partners in conserving this. And then as you see that as it gets higher, you see that the other areas along the coastline around that Powderhorn Ranch area, it becomes very important to provide habitat as well. So this is the model that we can use along the coast. It is a real scenario. And I think that really tells the best story as we go explore new areas and talk with new landowner partners. So the conservation resiliency along the coast doesn't mean it is just for wildlife, it's for the people too. We have such a rich heritage of history, of people coming to the Gulf Coast to make a new way of life, of having grand visions, of having pride in their land and in their communities. And so, you know, in some ways it's really neat to work in an area that does have a lot of small rural communities and connectivity, because it's something that we all share. And we have yet to run into someone who says, well, I don't want whooping cranes to come, but they do have, you know, questions about what that means and how that can impact them. And so the work that Terry's doing with our partners in being able to give them a suite of examples of how they can continue to work and still be sensitive to the needs of the cranes is very key to the success of our program. In addition, working with land trusts, who, especially these regional land trusts that work very closely with an area of, you know, of working with them and helping them with letters of support for any new acquisitions or easements, of helping them track the progress. And so that they get their fair share of that success story, I think is going to be really great as we move forward. And so as we, you know, as we close this, this seminar and look for questions, I think that it's really, we don't have to really speak for the whooping crane, we're there and we're representing the crane, but it only takes being around them for just a very short while to realize how independent and fierce and majestic that they are. They rule the marsh, they rule wherever they are, and they are able to reproduce and continue to increase their population as they should. And it's just up to us to make sure that when they come down to the Texas coast, that there is places for them to be part of this resilient community. And with that, Terry and I would like to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Liz and Terry. I guess, hi, everybody. I'm Lizzie. You may have seen me at a previous webinar, and I work on the North America team. That was fantastic, and we have a lot of questions. I don't think that we're going to be able to get to all of them, and so for people whose questions we don't answer live today, we will try to follow up with you afterwards. A few people want to know how the big winter storm in Texas affected the whooping cranes.
Well, having been out in the middle of it, on the water checking, they come from cold climates, and so they did fine. Food sources were a little tough. They changed some dietary habits, but and Liz probably has more about it, but I think they did fine overall.
Yeah, it was really interesting. It was so cold here during that. You know, I know that so many, a majority of the United States has colder weather than we do at some point in time.
Right.
But this was a very extended freeze, lasted several days. Certainly to the human community, it was very, very tough because we lost our power grid in Texas. It failed. And we just weren't prepared for that. And no water, no electricity for days. We were really, you know, struggling. Meanwhile, the cranes were leaving the marshes. The crabs had buried into the mud, deep into the mud to survive. And they were actually feeding on the fresh, dying and freshly killed fish from the freeze. And so they ate the small ones. Pretty soon they were picking out the better parts of larger ones. And it's really incredible how they adapted to it. And once that resource was gone and the crabs were back, they went back in. We do think that the crabs weren't as numerous afterwards. We did have an earlier migration, but it, you know, we can't really say that for sure, but they did leave a little bit earlier.
And I guess on that same subject, a couple people were asking about how do we protect cranes during a hurricane, or how do they survive?
Okay, well, you know, fortunate for us, our hurricane season is from June 1st until November 30th. Mm-hmm. And most of the time in the later, you know, the fall months, we don't get as many hurricanes in the northwestern Gulf of Mexico. So they are not here. The Aransas wood buffalo population is not here during the active season. They can be impacted though by any kind of destruction, et cetera, that happens during that hurricane. But in these big marshes, these big expanses of native habitat, it's resilient. It bounces back. Water may change course, but where something erodes, something accretes.
Mm-hmm.
For the Louisiana population, they're there all year. They did experience two hurricanes in one season,
mm-hmm.
That went over them. And our partners with the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries were just waiting it out, and their own selves concerned about their,
yeah,
about their homes, et cetera. And then, but then we're able to go out and locate those birds that had transmitters on them and felt that they actually just kind of hunkered down in place. Basically, it's unbelievable, unprecedented information for this. So they did good.
Yeah, really cool. There are a few questions about private landowners. Do we want to enter into a legal agreement with private landowners that we want to be stewards of the land?
Terry?
Well, at least, that's not a difficult question. I'm just thinking of all the aspects.
Yeah.
At least working with them, with wildlife management plans, with what they would actually have to consider when, if a population or if a pair of birds move onto their properties, whooping cranes move onto their properties. But we're always willing to work with coastal landowners. And as far as stewardship agreements, we're here to help. That would be an internal question that we would talk about, but as far as written agreements, but we will help landowners any way we can. So yes.
Okay. Right. And it really is something that, you know, that we're preparing and going to provide a portfolio of opportunities, mm-hmm. For these landowners to consider. And oftentimes it can be overwhelming. And so, mm-hmm. Being able to be there with them and walk through that with them, be their liaison to these to our conservation partners is something that we feel is something needed, and we really enjoy doing it.
Okay. Are invasive grasses an issue?
Somewhat. I'm thinking of that are now seem common grasses, King Ranch blue stem and all, but most of our invasive grasses are not salt tolerant. So what we're dealing with in salt marshes is native species predominantly. And you know, they've adapted over eons to be saltwater tolerant. So we've got some invasive brush species and some native brush species that you might consider invasive. Just changing habitats, but we're watching the mangrove closely, and
yeah,
it recovers with or if it doesn't recover with the freezes, because it's not freeze tolerant. So
yeah. Okay. How big is the King Ranch?
Last I checked, over 800,000 acres. So When we leave out of civilization, we used to joke about, because there were no gas stations, for 74 miles, you're driving through one ranch. And it's truly an expansive land. It's beautiful, beautiful, yeah. Myriad of habitats. Just it's a neat section of the world. We're glad they're with us, yeah, as with all our large landowners. It's amazing. So.
Do you think at some point that the Aransas wood buffalo migratory population and the Louisiana non-migratory populations might mix?
I'm going to let Liz take that one. That's wishful thinking on my part, but that's.
Well, you know, I don't see why not. you know, there's the historic maps that have been put together. We basically, the Gulf Coast Prairies and Marshes ecoregion is our recovery goal for them to be back and populated back into that area. Certainly moving southward is a little bit more difficult because of the loss of a very productive and, you know, world-renowned Rio Grande Delta. And it barely trickles to the Gulf, so that habitat is more lost. But as they move north eastward, and this expansion, this natural expansion that the Louisiana non-migratory population is already doing, you know, keep in mind, you know, there are about 75 birds, and, you know, 4 to 6 are in, you know, in East Texas at any given time. But we, you know, we kind of hope that that happens, being from Texas, and certainly there to support that. And then there's this exploration that is, you know, we don't have any background on how these birds explore and establish in new habitats. And we're seeing it happen. It's very exciting. Yeah. So we wait to see. Certainly there's some kind of more governmental issues with the non-migratory populations, you know, an introduction, reintroduction population coming and expanding. But as far as we're concerned, you know, it's going to just make the recovery stronger and the species more successful.
Exactly.
Awesome. I have a couple of questions about crawfish. Do whooping cranes eat them?
Very much so. It's a main part of their diet when they move into these fields, and crustacean, and it offers a lot of protein for them. So we see them expanding that way. And fortunately, humans love crawfish also. So it's only going to get more and more habitat added to it. So I think so. Yes.
And another question about crawfish. Is crawfish meat yield, is crawfish yield measured in meat weight or gross weight?
Gross weight. By the sack or by the pound, live weight, as we call it, live weight.
Okay, cool. Very cool. So there's a question. My family has some property on the coast, and we want to learn more about coastal wildlife and what we can do to help. ICF provide any resources?
Well, and we love to hear that. That's a great question. We would love to hear from you. We are all biologists on staff. We love working with landowners. Y'all are the future of our whooping crane expansion, and any way we can assist, whether it's just consultation, just talking, looking at habitat, any needs, we will work with our conservation partners to provide funding if there's specific needs on a ranch, or just in general management and preparation for future whooping cranes coming to properties, or if you've had whooping cranes on your property. So, and when we benefit whooping cranes with better habitat, it increases habitat for all coastal wildlife species. So we love working with landowners. Please feel free to contact us.
Thank you, Terry. And we will follow up with that and with other questions that we haven't had time to answer today. Thank you, everybody, for asking such interesting questions and for being here at the webinar. My last question for you is, what can all of us watching do to help cranes?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for taking the time out to attend this webinar and all of our others. They're just absolutely amazing learning and awareness tools. Become a member if you're not a member. That certainly is what we live on is memberships and donations and support. you know, if you, there's a particular program that you'd like to support, certainly, you know, indicate that. If the, some of the work that we're doing here in Texas interests you and you'd like to support that, then please indicate that if you make a donation. It's just great to have so many people come up to us and say, I know who you are and I love International Crane Foundation and we feel very proud to be a part of it.
Yes.
Awesome.
Okay, well, I do want to thank our sponsors today, Taddy McAllister and Bob Richter, very, very supportive and wonderful, you know, people. And I really am pleased that you supported us in this seminar. And if you'd like to sponsor another webinar, please contact Kate at this address or phone number. And please join us for our next From the Field webinar, the rehabilitation of a distressed species, the gray crown cranes in Rwanda, by Dr. Barry Hardup, our Director of Conservation Medicine, and also by Founder and Executive Director of Rwanda in Rwanda Wildlife Conservation Association, Dr. Olivier Nsimenagana. And this will be sponsored by Janet and Andy Raddatz. And it's 2 weeks from now at 11 a.m. on April 29th. And thank you so much for your support. And we would love to hear from you.
Thank you, Lizzie. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Liz.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.